Thank you so much, everyone, for coming. I really appreciate you coming on a Friday night. I'm sure you'd rather be out drinking, but maybe you'll need a drink after this. I'd like to say a little bit about the event before we get started. First of all, you know, it's wonderful that we've got these volunteers here. We're not all official representatives of these candidates, so there may be questions we are not able to answer, so please be a little forgiving with us. That's one thing. Another thing I was asked to talk about was, why do we want to do this event? Well, one of my key issues is I really want to motivate people to vote. There are about 8 million Americans living overseas. This is a really important voting block, I believe. We're not all in Japan, but 8 million people is more than live in more than 20 states in the United States. Also, I have felt that many of my friends, maybe some of your friends, have been a bit, discouraged from voting by some of the stories in the media. Maybe they don't like a candidate. Maybe they don't like two candidates. Maybe they don't know who two candidates are. But I really want people to vote knowing something about the candidates. Robert and I have been talking about this event since August, for about 2 months. Should we do a debate? How should we do it? Well, one of the reasons we're not doing a debate is because we've seen how the debates have gone, and from the debates, we're not really finding out a lot about the issues. We're not finding out a lot about how they stand. And also, not all the candidates are allowed to participate in the debates. The other reason is, really, if we wanted to have a fun event, just have like four actors come up, we could just ask Tokyo Comedy Store to come up and do impersonations. It would be raucous good time, but you still wouldn't learn about the stances on the issues. So that's what we're going to be doing tonight. Our four, including myself, our four panelists tonight will be presenting the views on some of the key themes from each of the candidates, and then we will open up the floor for discussion. Robert will be our able-bodied moderator, and we will hopefully have at least 30 minutes for questions, for comments. We ask for everything to be focused on the issues. That's all we ask, is tonight we want to focus on the policy platforms and the issues, because if you want to find out about people's private lives, just go on the internet. Okay, man? We don't need to do that here. That's not going to help anyone vote. And I just want to remind you, in the next room, we do still have people helping people with either voter registration or application for your absentee ballots, if you're an American citizen. Thank you very much. Okay, I guess I'm moderating and speaking. Okay.
Q&A.
Oh, okay. So allow me to moderate the panel discussion. Okay. Okay. So what we're going to do is we're going to work in this order. We will have Alex, who will be speaking, Alex from Democrats Abroad, will be speaking on behalf of Clinton's policies. And our timekeeper is right over here. 10 minutes from each person. Thank you very much, Alex. Oh, really?
Motivation. Good evening, everyone. Thank you for coming. It's very good to know that there are so many people concerned about the election and that they're ready to see real talk about the issues. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Alexander Gonzalez. There's a reason why I'm wearing the Bernie shirt and the Bernie pin. I was a delegate for Bernie Sanders for the convention this year. When I first listened to Bernie Sanders talk in a park a year and a half ago, surrounded by a small number of cameras and hit home a message that resonated with a lot of Americans. It enlisted me to participate in this presidential campaign more than ever. I was motivated to participate and to volunteer and to contribute as much of my time as possible. And I saw a man who was truly for the people and by the people. So Bernie Sanders pulled me into this election, and I've gone through the whole process from A to Z. And his message has always been about the issues. He always deflected away from the personal issues, the gossip, the personal agendas of other people. He always deflected that sort of talk from everybody else. At the convention, we saw a large array of motivated and energized people ready for change. And during the convention, as I met other Clinton supporters and other Bernie supporters and people who were undecided, it became clear that although we differed on the manner in which we were going to execute our agenda, the ideals were all the same. It was very clear that we wanted to achieve healthcare reform, immigration reform. We wanted to have a concrete plan for infrastructure, to create jobs, to pull poor families out of the disparity they live in. So with that said, it pulled me to support Hillary more and more. And eventually, I came to the realization that if I continue to support the progressive Democrats that are running for office, to support the progressive agenda, and to do it with Hillary Clinton, that the goals that we fought for and the message that Bernie Sanders was conveying for a year and a half was more than attainable. So without further ado, let me present to you Hillary's plan. It's a very well-structured, concrete plan. The first 100 days include about 12 policies that are very ambitious, that are going to be fast-tracked to the Senate and to the Supreme Court, and will hopefully make some lay the foundation for some pretty incredible changes. First, it's important to note that the down-ballot candidates are just as equally important in this race as the presidential candidates. So with a Congress that is united and that is on the same page and has the same plan and follows the platform that we so strongly built, we'll be able to make these changes accordingly. Hillary's first 100 days include a plan for infrastructure, an unprecedented plan that has not been seen since World War II, of $300 billion. It's gathering a lot of, there's a lot of anticipation for it to create jobs in infrastructure, building bridges, lowering the costs of transportation, building roads, better access to rural communities, connecting the United States to 100% internet by the year 2024, recreating the recreating energy infrastructure. It's a pretty ambitious plan. It's hoping to create many jobs unlike ever seen before, and with a stronger economy, we can hopefully implement some of the more other challenging policy reforms that we were looking for with Bernie Sanders, such as higher minimum wage and equal pay for everyone. Citizens United is a campaign is a issue I think that is very important to a lot of people. As I went across the United States and having worked for Bernie's campaign and having talked to people, the biggest issue you see is that they want money out of politics. It's very clear. It's negatively influencing the way politics is run. It's overshadowing the voice of the people. And quite simply, most people are in agreement that we want to see it gone. So there is a plan to reverse the Citizens United decision, first of all by putting into the Supreme Court nominations that are anticipating to come up, to begin a plan to overturn Citizens United and to make a constitutional amendment to reform the way money influences politics. Last but not least, the third most principal issue for Hillary Clinton in her first 100 days of office is immigration reform. This hits on a more personal note for me. My parents immigrated to the United States, having escaped the Civil War in Guatemala. They came illegally. I think my mother came with only $20 in her pocket. My dad took a bus all the way up north. And during those times, it was very difficult to obtain any sort of citizenship without illegal help. So there are millions of families across the United States that are hoping for sensible immigration reform, and Hillary Clinton has a plan in action, or a plan that she wants to implement, which very much has to do with reforming the way we fast-track citizens to, undocumented immigrants to a path to residency and a path to citizenship. And it also makes sure that we have a tested and verified vetting process for prospective immigrants to come into the country. So it's important that we call them by what they are. They are not illegals. That is a term for actions, for things. It is not a term for a human being. A human being is not illegal. And if we are to use the proper term, we're going to use undocumented. Two more issues that resonate very strongly with progressive Democrats, real quick, is health care. Hillary Clinton has a plan for restructuring health care. Restructuring Obamacare. She's going to strengthen it, lower the cost of prescription drugs, lower premiums, and make competition between private companies a little bit better so that costs will be lowered. It's quite different from Donald Trump's plan, and it'll be revealed in the first few months after she hopefully takes the presidency. And last but not least, education. 1 minute. Education is very much at the heart of the progressive Democrats' agenda. And that's why her and Bernie Sanders have worked together, and she has adopted many of his policies to ensure that those with $125,000 or less get free education at all public universities and colleges, and that we restructure debt for those that are already paying debt. So I hope you take these issues into consideration. Take a look at her website. Take a look at the Democratic platform. It's a platform that's structured to have a plan for all Democrats that are going to be in office soon. And please go out and register. Thank you very much.
And now we have, on behalf of Jill Stein, Richard from, US
Greens Abroad.
U.S. Greens Abroad, not Abroad U.S. Greens. No, U.S. Greens Abroad. Thank you very much.
Right, thank you very much for inviting me to come here. I'm Richard Evanoff from the U.S. Greens Abroad, and I'm really pleased to be here because the Greens are excluded from the presidential debates, but we're invited to be here to be able to present our points of view, so thank you very much. I've got a lot of stuff to go through. I'm going to stay on script. I've got mine here, and I passed out some sheets around in the audience if you can get a copy. It includes a lot of information about the Greens in general, about Jill Stein. It includes an outline of the Green Party platform and also the full document of the full text of Jill Stein's platform, right, for the 2016 election. Let me begin by talking a little bit about the Greens. The Greens are often characterized as a leftist party. We are not a leftist party. Our slogan is neither left nor right, but straight ahead. And I want to explain a little bit about the philosophy of the Greens first to kind of give you an orientation, because we're thinking in a completely different paradigm from the way the other parties are thinking. And it's very, very difficult for us to get our message through in sound bites. So it does require a little bit of explanation. I would think that the Greens are probably the heirs to Thomas Jefferson. Jefferson's idea is that democracy only works if political power and wealth are widely spread in society. And we do not have a society like that right now. And the Greens are probably the only party that's represented here that is trying to think of an alternative to capitalism. Right. Basically, the Democrats are supporting capitalism. Right. And then if, you know, we have inequality, how do we handle that? Well, we need, you know, welfare or something. Right. Republicans and libertarians are saying, let's get rid of the welfare system so that capitalism is unbridled. What the Greens are looking for is an alternative to capitalism. And the alternative is an alternative that involves spreading wealth widely in society, but not trying to use the state to do that. Right? We're opposed to any form of state socialism that says, you know, we want the government to become really big. That's something we share with the libertarians and the Republicans, right? We don't want big government. What we want, we don't want the government in control. We don't want the capitalists in control. We want the people in control. And how do we do that? Now, we recognize we're a minority. We're only polling 3% right now. We're the losers up here. But we think that, you know, we need to start a discussion about these issues now. And another problem is, right, capitalism is not sustainable. When we look at the long term, you know, Marxism and capitalism are both based on the idea that we can continue growing our economy indefinitely. And all of the political parties in the world, with the possible exception of Bhutan, right, have the idea of how we can, you know, increase our GNP. And the Greens are thinking, how do we make a sustainable economy? Now, we have to go through a transition period to do that. So in the process of talking about this, I'm going to go through a couple of policies that Jill Stein has, right? Similar to the Democrats, who have the idea of, you know, increasing investment in infrastructure, the Greens are proposing the idea of a Green New Deal. And it's very similar to Hillary Clinton's proposal, the idea that we should be investing in infrastructure and that sort of thing, except that, right, we want to be focusing on the transition to a genuinely sustainable economy. And what that means is not investing in, you know, infrastructure that's going to be promoting the goals of, you know, more economic growth, right? But rather infrastructure that promotes the idea of a sustainable economy. And so what we want to be doing is doing things like investing in green energy, right? Investing in things like, you know, like providing for housing, insulation for housing, these kinds of things, right? And also, similar to the Democrats, it's a Green New Deal. So the idea is that we should, you know, be shifting our economy away from, right, employment aimed at increasing consumerism towards the idea of aiming our economy towards creating this more sustainable economy. Right, and the idea is to create 20 million new jobs in sustainable energy, right, mass transit, organic agriculture, clean manufacturing, and improved infrastructure, right, and then increasing the number of social work, right, teaching, healthcare, after-school home care, drug rehabilitation, and other service jobs. So that's our focus on the economy, and we also want to shift away from fossil fuels to 100% clean energy, right, by the year 2030, which seems to be pretty necessary for us to do if we intend to have any kind of decent life for ourselves in the future. In terms of economy and trade, right, some of the policies Jill Stein recommends is establishing the right to a living wage for all Americans with $15 per hour as set as a federal minimum wage, ensuring equal work for equal pay, supporting the workers' rights to form labor unions, achieve workplace democracy, and keep a fair share of the wealth that they create. And on this point, you know, the Greens are really interested in the idea of promoting any type of businesses, small businesses, cooperatives, right, local businesses, local economies that can keep money inside the community. So it's quite different from the idea of globalization, right, that we want the big multinational companies to be, you know, kind of controlling what's going on in the world, but rather try to keep the company the economy focused as much as possible at the local level so that we can keep money inside the local communities. And this is part of the Jeffersonian idea, again, of trying to spread wealth in society, but doing it not by public ownership, but by private ownership, so that wealth is spread among individuals, right? Not concentrated in the hands of the state or the big multinational corporations, right? Some other proposals from Jill, break up the two big failed banks, create some democratically run public banks and utilities, replace NAFTA and other corporate free trade agreements that export American jobs, depress wages, and undermine the right of Americans and citizens of other countries to control their own economies and political choices. And replace, you know, the corporate international multinational trade treaties with fair trade laws that benefit local workers and communities. All right. Also interested in abolishing student debt and guaranteeing tuition-free public education from preschool through university, and increasing government revenues for social needs like Medicare and Social Security by restoring full employment, while cutting the bloated military budget and private health health insurance waste. And I think, you know, the idea here is, right, we have an economy right now in the United States in which wealth is concentrated in the top 1%. And how do we get wealth, you know, to spread among the other 99%? And the idea is, if we can do that, if we can spread wealth widely in society, we don't really need welfare. Right? Welfare is only something that you need if wealth is unequally spread in society. But if you spread it more widely in society, you don't need things like welfare. So we come very close to some, you know, libertarian ideas. The idea we could have a flat tax, right? Everybody pays the same tax. We don't need a progressive income tax. Because if wealth is widely spread in society, we don't really need, right, to have a progressive income tax. Everybody's going to be paying very, very similar, right? Everybody's going to be making similar incomes, and therefore everybody could be paying more similar taxes, right? So some of the specific things, right? Establishing maximum and minimum incomes, right, that to reduce the wage gap between rich and poor. Reducing income inequality spreads wealth more widely in society. More equal incomes can be taxed at more equal rates, resulting in greater tax equality. Full employment at a living wage reduces welfare costs. Eliminating unnecessary overconsumption reorients the economy to meeting people's basic human needs and reduces environmental stress. And a simple measure, such as making products that last twice as long, that can reduce the work week. Julia Shore, an economist at Harvard University, she calculated that simply by making products that last longer, we could reduce the work week to 20 hours per week, and at the same time be able to make products that we, you know, use in our everyday life and reduce stress on the environment, because we wouldn't be making so much junk, right? Wouldn't be using so much resources, right? Wouldn't be wasting so much energy, creating so much pollution and so forth. Immigration and criminal justice, very similar to the Democrats, the idea of trying to halt deportation and detentions of law-abiding undocumented immigrants. And also then maybe an important green emphasis is the idea of trying to improve economies in other countries. Because right now, if we're giving ODA basically on the basis of trying to pull people into the global economy, this is taking jobs away from people inside local economies. And then when people in local economies don't have jobs, they immigrate. But if we can build strong local economies abroad, as we do in the United States, then people have less incentive to want to leave their countries. Right, thank you. Right. I do need a drink. Okay, basically, right. You know, we recognize, the Greens recognize that we don't have a realistic chance of winning the 2016 election. But like Bernie Sanders, you know, we think that by trying to run a campaign, we can get some of these issues out to the public, start to get some of these issues discussed, right? And I know that, you know, Greens are often accused, too, of being spoilers because we're supposed to take away votes from the Democrats. But actually, to tell the truth, we wouldn't mind taking votes away from the other candidates as well. But even though we recognize that it's a long shot for us to be able to win this election, we think that if we start to get these ideas out now, it's going to be easier to convince people in the future as these changes take place in society, as we find it increasingly difficult for us to be able to continue this economic growth. We need to be talking about these issues. So we want to start the conversation now about this. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I will be going next. My name is Sarajean Rossitto. I teach at Temple University in the continuing ed department, but I work as a nonprofit consultant here in Tokyo. I am on every group's mailing list. However, I could not find a speaker for Governor Johnson and Governor Weld, so I will be speaking on their behalf, representing some of their policies. Any of you who have seen me speak before know I never use a piece of paper, but please forgive me today for using notes. First, I'd like to share some information about what Governors Johnson and Weld see as some of the key issues in this campaign. I'd like to start a little bit with the deficit, talk a little bit about immigration and foreign policy, and then the environment. If there's enough time, I'd like to just touch on a few of the other libertarian issues. I'd like to start with his plan for the first 100 days. Well, what he sees as the biggest threat to the U.S. security today is actually the national deficit. So he believes that in the first 100 days, the most important thing for them to do is to submit a balanced budget for Congress and work with Congress on passing that balanced budget. This $20 trillion deficit is not the responsibility of either party alone, so all parties must work together on creating a balanced budget. He believes that it would be important to start with a 43% cut to the US military budget. And how would this happen? Well, he believes that it would be able to start with first a reduction in US military presence in our allied nations, say as Japan, South Korea, and in European countries. Also, end all involvement in Iraq and Afghanistan, and also reducing the nuclear arsenal. We know that we can blow up the world how many times, and it's just not necessary for us to keep investing in that. All of this would require cuts as well in research and development, intelligence systems, and in military uniform personnel. He believes that international military action should be a last option and that the U.S. has no business being a police officer for the world. Our military should be a defensive force, not an offensive force, and should only be involved as necessary. Johnson does not consider himself to be an isolationist and believes that this huge military budget is a waste of our resources. Resources that we could be better spent here domestically, not in Japan, in the United States, in our infrastructure and in creating an environment for jobs. He supports some free trade and is a bit suspect of some agreements, such as the TPP, but does believe that getting rid of tariffs and free trade agreements would really help economic prosperity here and abroad. He believes that the regulatory and tax environment should really incentivize a fair competition. Fair is a key word. If you look at johnsonweld.com, the website, you will see that appears again and again. Because while it's important for government regulation to exist in a limited way, government regulation should allow not just the multinational corporations to have access to markets, but it should allow entrepreneurs and smaller business people also to have access. You know, actually, multinational corporations benefit from regulation because they have the lobbyists. They create the regulations that allow their businesses to work as they please. You know, so this really kicks the small entrepreneurs, the people, this medium-sized business people out of the realm of fair competition. He takes a similar stance when he looks at environmental issues. Now, the EPA, the Environmental Protection Agency, has an important role. We all need clean water. We need clean air. But believes that some of the EPA regulations are just too restrictive and often favor certain business interests. For example, green energy. Yes, EPA should be going after those polluters, but they should not favor, government policy should not favor industries such as solar power. He does believe in the necessity of energy independence and diversity of our energy sources. But this diversity should include coal, it should include nuclear power, should be gas, include gas. When it comes to climate change, he agrees that, of course, climate change is happening. But it is really a waste of time for us to talk about who caused it. What we need to focus on is preserving our environment, conserving nature for future generations, and doing that together. He believes that actually if we have a better economic situation where everybody has a more fair chance to be in the middle class, that actually we will have a better environment, although I cannot explain exactly how this will come about. So let me also go on to immigration as time is quickly going by. In the area of immigration, he believes it's important that we reform policy to actually make it easier for people to become American citizens. People go to the United States to work. People go to the United States as they have for the past 200 years to have a better life. So why not make it easier for people to get visas? Why not create a more effective and efficient system so that people can go to the United States, can work, and make it easier for them to become naturalized citizens? And we need to respect the diversity of all Americans, of all people coming to the United States, because that is what the U.S. is based on. And the system should also encourage everyone to pay taxes, be part of the system, and he believes that we need to create a pathway for illegal aliens. People who've been members of society, working, contributing to society, should have an easy pathway for getting more involved. So in the last 2 minutes, I'd like to just touch on a few other things, such as the area of health and social welfare. He believes the government should not be in the business of health care. He believes that we should repeal the Affordable Care Act Affordable Medications Act. Social Security should be privatized over time. However, for those who have been paying into the system, this should be part of a gradual process of privatization of Social Security. We can't just take away from the people who've been paying into it. He supports criminal justice reform and does not believe that stricter punishments alone will reduce crime. Politicians have criminalized way too many aspects of people's lives that the government should just not be involved in. Drug addiction is a health issue. It's not a crime issue, and we need to deal with it as such. When it comes to the Second Amendment, he's a staunch believer in everyone's right to bear arms, but we need to take guns out of the hands of people who might commit crimes with them. He also believes that no one deserves to have a military grade weapon. So basically, as I'd like to wrap up, I'd like to, when it comes to people's personal freedoms, government needs to stay out of our private lives. Government needs to stay out of our cell phones, out of our bedrooms. Everyone has the right to marry who they want. Abortion, although he disagrees with it on a personal level, believes that Roe v. Wade is the law of the land, and this is a woman's choice to decide. He does not believe in mandatory vaccines as well, because this is a family's right to decide, and that church and state need to be separated. Thank you very much. And in wrapping up, I'd just like to say it's important to keep in mind that Governors Weld and Johnson are the only two people running for President of the United States who have executive experience as government officials. They are the only two that have experience cutting taxes, and they are the only two that have created an environment for jobs to be created. Not creating jobs through government funds, but creating an environment where jobs can be created. Thank you very much. Oh, sorry. Next. Next, I would like to introduce John, who's been wonderful to come on, join us just today. He is part of Japan for Trump, and he's going to tell us a little bit about the stances of Donald Trump, things that maybe you might not even know if you've been following the news. Thank you very much, John.
Thanks, Sarah Jane. Yes, I should say before I start that I was a last minute pinch hitter in this event tonight. The previous speaker was planning to speak, but he was taken ill at the last minute. As you can probably also tell from my accent, I'm not American. So whatever happens and whatever we're persuaded to do tonight, I won't be casting a vote in this election. And this slot was offered to many Americans here in Japan. However, we found that most were reluctant to take it. Support for Trump is in many ways a very underground thing. And what I found is that many people are afraid to actually come out and say, I support Donald Trump in this election. They're worried about the social consequences, the employment consequences, and I find that very disturbing. Actually, I think that's a very disturbing path that we've taken in this decade, in this campaign. So I would like to see that changed. Whatever happens in this election, I hope that that is reversed and we don't keep heading down this path. So anyway, onto Donald Trump's campaign. I think it's pretty fair to say that the entirety of Donald Trump's campaign is unashamedly pro-American. It's very nationalistic, and you could even say it's somewhat protectionist in nature. He's aimed squarely at the American working class. Now, the American working class feels that it's been left out of whatever gains have been made in the past 20, 30 years. They feel like they've had a raw deal in many of America's trade deals. And they feel that there's a certain cast of what they call globalist elites who are acting in their own interests, serving the political establishment, the business establishment, the media establishment, and the average person. The average American, the average working American, is being completely left out of this picture. And he's looking to reverse that as much as possible. He's very much an anti-establishment campaign. That's quite evident in the fact that he has just as much opposition from the Republican Party as he does from the Democrat Party. So he's also running a mainly self-funded campaign. He has not taken any large donations from corporate interests. Many of his own party's major donors have refused to support him in this campaign. And I think that's also an important aspect of his campaign, because it shows that he's not beholden to special interests in the same way that other candidates may be. Anyway, I guess it's about time to move on to specific policies. Now, I was quite surprised listening to the other presentations tonight that there are many, many aspects of Trump's campaign, or many policies in Trump's agenda, that are quite similar to the others. And I found specific policies were contained in all three of the other candidates' platforms. Trump is all about jobs. He's all about American jobs. He wants to recreate, you know, a vibrant, booming American economy that grows at roughly 3%, 4% per year, which is something that we haven't seen for the last 8 years. And he's going to... Sorry, I do need to consult my notes on these. Specifically, some of the policies include... He has a pro-growth tax plan, a new modern regulatory framework, and an America First trade policy. Now, I mean, these slogans sound great, but what exactly is an America First trade policy? He would take a very close look at some of the trade agreements, the so-called free trade agreements that America has signed up for and ratified and not ratified in the past 2 decades. He would like to renegotiate NAFTA. Now, it's very funny, but all Americans of all political stripes like to complain to me about NAFTA. No one, it doesn't seem to be very popular with anybody, really. He says he wants to eliminate specifically Mexico's one-sided tariff through the VAT. And he says that Mexican sweatshops are taking low-level jobs away from American workers. He would like to see them abolished. He would like to take steps to renegotiate NAFTA so that they cannot exist anymore. And these jobs will return back to America. He wants to withdraw from the Trans-Pacific Partnership. Now, I think most people I talk to in Japan would also like to withdraw from the Trans-Pacific Partnership. As Donald Trump has pointed out, this agreement has not been ratified by the U.S. yet, and he could quite easily pull out of it. He wants to appoint new trade negotiators. Trump sees himself, rightly or wrongly, as a master negotiator, and he believes that he can find the right people to get the best deal for America in every situation. Now, Trump is pro-American. He's not worried if these jobs for Americans come at the expense of people in other countries. And so I think you'll find that whatever actions he takes as president, they will be very pro-American. You know, protectionist even. That seems to be going against the trend that the globalists have set forth on for the last 2 decades. You know, the world is heading towards open borders and free trade. But I think a lot of people in America and Western countries in general are finding that this has not worked for them. Their lives are not better as a result. Another major concern of Trump's in the trade arena is China. He says that China is a currency manipulator. And if elected, he will take immediate steps to have the Treasury Secretary label China a currency manipulator. He'll bring cases against China in the US and the WTO to make sure that China fulfills its legal obligations. And that involves abolishing subsidies and tariffs that protect Chinese goods at the expense of American at the moment. Okay, so that's jobs in the economy. He also has a plan called a penny plan. And the penny plan reduces non-defense and entitlement spending by 1% each year. Now, that penny plan has the potential to save $1 trillion over 10 years if all government spending is reduced by 1% every year and helps get the government out of our lives. He's a staunch defender of the First and the Second Amendment. He sees both of those as being under grave threat at the moment and will do whatever he can to defend them. On international policy, of course, once again, Trump wants to promote and defend America's national interests at home and abroad. So most importantly, he wants to end the current strategy of nation building and regime change. However, he also wants to increase defense spending. That probably flies in the face of some of the other policies you've heard tonight. He wants to increase the size of the US Army to 540,000 active duty soldiers. He wants to increase the size of the U.S. Navy to 350 ships and the Air Force to 1,200 fighter aircraft. He also wants to invest in a serious missile defense system to defend the U.S. against sophisticated attacks from major countries. Trump's stance on immigration is also very well known. In fact, it's probably the most, after trade, the most well-known platform of his campaign. Yes, Trump wants to build a wall on the Mexico border. I think we've seen so far that one is not negotiable. Trump supporters would probably riot if that doesn't happen. Trump likes to build things. He's going to build a wall. He's going to end the catch and release system, by which people who were found to be in the U.S. illegally were let go after they were arrested. He wants to end the Sanctuary City program. And basically, he just says he wants to enforce all immigration laws as they stand. He wants to triple the number of ICE agents. He says that under the present administration, those laws have been let go, they're not enforced anymore, and they're being abused by certain people. You know, whether they be honest or dishonest people, they're being abused. And he wants to increase the amount of legal and skilled immigration into the U.S., which is another policy that benefits the U.S. It may not benefit people outside the U.S., but that's not his job, and it's not America's job. Trump's overarching slogan is Make America Great Again. Everyone has their different concept of that, but I hope you're all going to register and vote tonight according to whatever your concept of that is. Make America Great Again. Thank you.
So thank you very much. Thank you, Sarajean, for organizing this. Thank you to all the other speakers. And first and foremost, thank you for keeping within the time limit. You know, we're in Japan, we're punctual. Japan is great, it is punctual. We're gonna have a discussion, questions. Anybody wants to raise his or her hand? And the process is you can go to the center aisle, and therefore the microphone will pick up your voice and your face. If you're here incognito and want neither to be heard nor seen, you can speak up from your seat so we will hear you, but it will not be recorded because your voice will not be caught by the system. So, I mean, this is a very silent group. Okay, well.
Thank you guys so much. I know Johnson's representative talked about it a little bit, but I'm wondering if you can all tell me within, like, you know, just one sentence response, what's your view on legalizing marijuana and abortion?
Marijuana is a very hot topic now. There's a lot of states voting to legalize it. From Hillary's point of view, quite simply, she believes that it's up to the states to decide whether or not they want to issue a recreational or repeal the illegal use of it and to use it recreationally. From a federal standpoint of view, her focus is going to mirror President Obama's, and it's going to shift away from enforcing marijuana laws. Abortion. I think it's unquestionable that Secretary Clinton is a huge proponent for the woman's right to decide what she gets to do with her body. She's in full support of Roe versus Wade, and she's going to make sure that the next Supreme Court justices fully support that ideal as well.
One point that I think the Greens share with the libertarians is trying to promote as much individual liberty as possible. So marijuana is a personal choice that doesn't affect others in society, and it should be something that individuals should have the right to do if they want to. And also a woman's choice in terms of an abortion as well.
Very quickly about drug use. Governors Weld and Johnson specifically focus on marijuana use and believing that we should remove cannabis from Schedule 1 of the Controlled Substances Law, and that this would make it easier for states to legalize marijuana. They do not see marijuana as a gateway drug, and that other drug addictions should be treated as a health concern, not as a crime issue, because it impacts the poor more than others. That's one issue. And then about abortion, although they do not believe in it, neither of them believe in it themselves, they believe that it is, that it's not the government's responsibility. However, they are both opposed to third-term or late-term abortions in far as what they have done in their own states.
Thanks. I believe Donald Trump sees marijuana in particular as a state issue, just the way it's being handled now. He is personally against all drugs, including alcohol, and he doesn't use any of them himself. As far as abortion goes, I think he made some comments in the media which were misrepresented on that issue. It's not an issue he feels personally strongly about. I think we would have to agree that to run as a Republican in the U.S., you have to take an official stance against abortion. However, the real politic of that situation is that very few Republican presidents have ever taken active measures to criminalize abortion once in power. Thanks.
Thanks. Thank you all for your presentation tonight. It was really great to see the Libertarian and the Green Party being represented, especially on this panel. But then a question goes to the foreign policy of the candidates, especially given that we are talking in Japan right now, and Japan has been the U.S.'s allies after 1945. So I was wondering if the candidates can briefly touch upon your foreign policies, especially that of against with Japan and the Asia Pacific. Thank you.
This is a issue that I'm personally very familiar with. I did 6 years in the Navy and I was an intelligence specialist. And this is a issue that the U.S. military and the U.S. Department of State always very closely works hand in hand with. As we all know, or as most of us know, Hillary Clinton was the Secretary of State. And she believes in the power of diplomacy, and in cooperating with our allies to maintain agreements and treaties that we have with them. And she believes it's the United States' responsibility to maintain and fulfill those responsibilities. And she's going to continue that. With respect to the to Asia and the Pacific pivot, Hillary Clinton is going to continue President Obama's legacy, although we should really call it the United States' legacy, because we are honing in on Asia. And over the next few years, it's going to be increasingly important to work with the Chinese, to work with the Japanese, the Koreans, to ensure that territories are respected, that treaties are followed and closely observed, and that military cooperation is of a more friendly nature and cooperative nature, as opposed to duking it out on the battlefield. So you're going to see that trend to continue with Hillary Clinton.
Yeah, I'm just going to read something from the Jill Stein's policy here about foreign relations. Establish a foreign policy based on diplomacy, international law, human rights, and nonviolent support for democratic movements around the world. I think maybe one of the key points of the Green Party is this emphasis on nonviolence. We're the only party that has this written into our 10 key values. So the idea of using violence as a way to settle international disputes is not an option for the Greens. And Jill Stein specifically also wants to try to reduce the military budget, the same as the libertarians do. She also advocates closing American-US bases. A country like Japan certainly has the military capacity. It's, I don't know, the seventh largest. You can, this, don't quote me on this, it could be wrong, but you know, Japan has got tremendous military spending, the ability to basically defend itself. The United States can still certainly be an ally of Japan, but the Greens don't see any reason for America to be the world's policeman either, and would favor closing American military bases around the world.
Besides what I mentioned before about reduction of bases in allied countries, Governors Weld and Johnson see the Japan-U.S. relationship as one being of trade and good trade partners. And they really believe in the importance of having open markets and limiting tariffs and quotas for whether it be different products or with different partners, so that, and eliminating endless barriers to free trade, because they believe this would only create jobs and provide better opportunities for American business. So they're seeing the relationship not in terms of security, but in terms of jobs.
Thanks. For Donald Trump's international relations policy, I think falls into two categories, which are trade and military. The official policy slogan is peace through strength, and that involves both military strength and economic strength. He wants to advance America's core national interests. That he will also promote regional stability and produce an easing of tensions in the world. He wants to rebuild the U.S. military. He wants to enhance and improve its missile defense and cyber defense and cyber offense capabilities as well. As I mentioned before, he also wants to end the current strategy of nation building and regime change. He sees them as very pointless activities. He wants to work with the U.S.'s Arab allies in the Middle East, and he wants to overwhelmingly defeat ISIS. With regards to trade, I think we covered that earlier on too. He's not seeking trade cooperation, although he does want to work with the US's international partners. He wants to put America first, and he wants policies that create American jobs first, not jobs in other countries. Thanks.
Thank you. My name is Gennari. I'd like to know what kind of a positive impact from Japan point of view we can get from all of the delegates who are represented here.
Positive impact. No more bases in Okinawa. Maybe that's a Libertarian and Green Party common thing.
Yeah. I think, the United States has a lot to learn from Japan. Article 9 of Japan's constitution says that Japan should, the military should basically be for purposes of defense.
I'd like to say discussion outside of a military defense-related issue.
Right.
So because that was, discussed before. So
right, okay.
So what kind of positive impact if all of the candidates who are represented here or selected as a president, then what kind of a positive impact Japan as a country or Japanese people might be able to see.
If elected.
Right.
Yeah.
Hmm?
Okay.
Oh, yeah, right, obviously. Yeah, if they were elected. Okay. That's true. That's true. I can see many negative things based on what I discussed so far.
I think it's a tough question, but.
Tough question.
It is. for Japan personally, and I think for any country here in Asia, Japan in particular, Hillary Clinton has a very strong foreign policy plan, and I touched a little bit of it earlier when I answered the earlier question. And a lot of it has to do with strengthening the economy in America and strengthening our economic cooperation with countries in Asia. We have a lot to benefit from that in various sectors, various other sectors like research and development. It looks like the space race is about to go on again. And from that perspective, I think the United States and Japan would continue to benefit from learning about each other's developments, learning about each other's economic strengths and weaknesses, and improving them for the better. And those are sort of outlined in Hillary's plans for restructure or for improving tensions in Asia. So from that standpoint, we could see Japan benefit immensely, I think.
Yeah, I do want to return a little bit to the previous point I was trying to make, because I think that the United States, the Green Party, would basically be supporting policies that would decrease the amount of globalization, decrease the amount of military spending in Japan, and basically what this would do would be to free up Japan. Japan is going to have to, you know, support itself militarily. The United States will still be your friend, but we're not going to have bases here. And in terms of trade, we're opposed to things like TPP, which basically means that, you know, that's going to hurt international trade in terms of what the multinational corporations are doing, but it is going to be beneficial for average ordinary people in Japan, people like farmers. Farmers are going to be devastated by TPP, right, with all these, you know, floods of, you know, goods coming in. And by not signing TPP, this actually supports, you know, Japanese farmers, supports Japanese agriculture, supports, you know, local economies here inside Japan. And I think that's a very positive thing, right? So you might say it's negative in the sense that, you know, we're opposed to globalization and, treaties and so forth. But this, I think, builds up Japan to become more independent from the United States, but still a partner and a friend.
I just want to put a disclaimer that this is not necessarily my belief system. all right. So by removing barriers, trade barriers, by removing quotas and tariffs, this is going to be good for businesses on both sides of the Pacific. By us actually working together to promote our businesses and both sides of the Pacific, it's really going to help businesses on both sides. This isn't going to be a one-way deal. This would mean that Japan would have to lower its own tariffs and make the market more accessible as well. So I'll move on to Trump. Thank you. That's a real challenge. That's what they believe.
How would Trump benefit Japan? Well. Of course, every country wants to make itself great. And again, I know that Trump has been a public figure for over three decades now, and he was on the record publicly stating in the 80s that he felt that Japan was ripping the US off on trade. These days he talks more about China, but back in the 80s, Japan occupied that position. I think we've heard other candidates talk about trade cooperation and free trade. We see that as just talk, and then talk is very nice. It sounds very nice, but in the reality, the cooperation we find is not working for America. It's working for everyone else, but it's not working for America. So what happens is that America is liberalizing its trade. But every other country it cooperates with is acting in its own self-interest. I think Trump wants America to act in its own self-interest too. On the whole though, I think that Donald Trump's plan to to reinvigorate the U.S. economy will be beneficial for Japan in the long run, because Japan and the U.S. are very close allies. They rely on each other. And a strong U.S. equals a strong Japan. They can both lean on each other. I think that's how we see it. Thanks.
One interesting thing is, first, Japan has been fairly absent from the debate. I mean, if you think of the discussions in the 80s, 90s, no, Japan is a threat, tariffs on Japan. I mean, essentially, I haven't looked at the transcript of the two debates, but I'm not sure the word Japan was uttered once. Or if it was like in passing in lots of countries. I mean, if they talk about Asia, it's entirely China-focused. Then it was a talk about the Middle East, Russia, partly because of its involvement in the campaign. But Japan's been kind of out, which may actually be good. I mean, you don't necessarily want to be on the front line of any debate. The other thing I think that's been noticeable, that's in terms of how Japan manages its foreign relations, is that in the past 10 years, maybe more, Japanese government, essentially the LDP governments, because except for 3 years was an LDP government, have really focused their attention on the Republican Party, and they've seen the Republicans as being more pro-Japan than the Democratic Party. This obviously has become a problem now, because from the point of view of what the LDP wants, they consider Clinton to be more pro-Japan than Trump. So I think they kind of missed how the Republican Party switched and how it's not the party that they thought it was 10 years ago. And they probably didn't invest enough in connecting with the Democratic Party. And I think in that sense, they partly missed the boat. But essentially, there's been very little talk about Japan during this election period. Even currency, well, especially now that the yen has reappreciated, it's not been on the front burner and not really on the back burner even.
If I may just say a few words real quick. This election is particularly hitting home very closely to a lot of Americans, because I think there's less talk about international issues and a little bit more concern and necessity for domestic issues. And right now, that's what's got Americans energized and ready. This is why you see the working class on the conservative side supporting Trump, and you have an immense working class supporting progressive Democrats and Bernie Sanders on the left. And the American people are, quite frankly, fed up with international policy and what's going on abroad. We've got to take care of the issues at home first. That's the most important thing. And everywhere I went in the United States, that was the number one recurring theme, was issues at home. So I think entering into these next 4 years, the next president has to, of course, concern themselves with issues abroad. But the number one thing is repairing America.
Here, here.
Yes, here, and then, oh, you had a question too? Okay, so here, then here, and then here. Okay, so you raise your hand first, so.
Thank you very much. I'm from Japan, so obviously I don't vote, so, but my question could be useful for the American people as well. My question is very simple. I would like to ask the all candidates concerning the view on the current state of America comparing with the America about in the 1950s. And based on that ontological view, I would like to ask all candidates the what kind of the U.S. they want to create. My key concern is about the whether the candidate want to create something new, or he or she want to create something, restore something which existed before. Thank you.
Well, Donald Trump's slogan is "Make America Great Again," so that suggests that America was great at some stage in the past, and it's not now, just by its very nature. The Daily Show went around asking people, you know, when exactly was America great? And of course, it would point out some negative aspect of that era, whatever the person suggested. I think what that proved is that everyone has a different concept of what made America great and what stage in history that occurred. To say that we would want to go back to the 1950s, not really, and it's not possible anyway, so it's probably not worth really even proposing. There were some aspects of the 1950s that were great. You can't recreate an era. You can just take aspects of that time that benefited the country and try and bring them back as best you can. Thanks.
I'm not exactly sure how to respond about the 50s part because there were also a lot of things in the a lot of people in the 50s that did not have access to their rights. And I think when we see the libertarian's standpoint is that everyone should have access to their rights and government should stay out of everyone's business. But if we look at the 50s, there's a lot of people that still did not have access to vote, did not have freedom of access to jobs, discrimination was a problem, and definitely gays did not have the right to marry who they wanted, men or women did not have the right to choose. So I think our Libertarian Party would say that the 50s is not the goal. The goal we're working towards is a place where government stays out of people's business but treats everybody equally. I don't think that's something new. I think that is something that is already in the original identity we have, but it's America, maybe you're familiar with the idea that America being a process rather than an end point. Oh, sorry, you have yours.
The Greens definitely want to do something new. We think that the policies of the past, they're not sustainable, they're not going to continue, and we need to be thinking not of what's going on right now in the 21st century, we need to be thinking about what goes on in the 22nd century. And so on the sheet that I've passed out, one of the topics is future focus and sustainability. This is one of the key 10 key values of the Greens, right? I'm just going to read it because it's short. Our actions and policies should be motivated by long-term goals. We seek to protect valuable natural resources, safely disposing of or unmaking all waste we create while developing a sustainable economics that does not depend on continual expansion for survival. That means the end of capitalism. Right, we must counterbalance the drive for short-term profits by assuring that economic development, new technologies, and fiscal policies are responsible to future generations who will inherit the results of our actions. We must make the quality of all lives, rather than open-ended economic growth, the focus of future thinking and policy.
I understand your question to be in a different context. Maybe going back to the 50s in the sense that we had a very nice economic boom and people could afford healthcare, a house, cars. And if I'm wrong, please correct me. But when I worked for Bernie Sanders' campaign, there was a gentleman who was uncertain about voting for him. And he had the opportunity to meet Bernie Sanders during one of his rallies. And he said, Bernie, I just want to make sure that when my son graduates, he can get a job, he can pay his college debt off, and he can marry, settle down, have a wife and kids, and have a home. And Bernie Sanders said, very simply, and this is a policy I believe that Hillary Clinton, or a point of view that Hillary Clinton very much agrees with, and it's something that united the two, is that there is nobody that could tell them that with a united Congress and with effective policies, that we could strive towards that goal of ensuring Americans benefit economically and at the same time are afforded the same opportunities and rights as anybody else. And it is very much an attainable future. And I believe that Hillary Clinton is setting up the country to be create an absolutely well-lubricated middle class. And it mirrors a lot of the concerns and issues that people have had over the past few years. So I think we could strive towards it.
My name is Khalil. I'm Ambassador of Bahrain. I really enjoyed all the speeches, and I'm very impressed with many of beautiful ideas there in this discussion. You know, Yani, I'm very impressed by the dynamics of the American election. I don't think anywhere in the world they have this sort of dynamics. At the same time, you really filter the candidates, squeeze them, and try to get the best of them. And that's very impressive. But there are a lot of challenges. You all discussed them. But, you know, and these challenges are causing polarization in the American politics. My question is, you know, before we lived in a world which was like a huge planet. Today, because of technology and globalization, we live in a very small global village. And there are many challenges. But these challenges, none of us can solve it alone. Economic challenges, climate challenges, you know. Tomorrow you have artificial intelligence. 40% of your job will be gone away. What are you going to do? Well, you don't think all these challenges now you are facing in your election and some of the polarization related to we are not having the right answer to the global challenges. This is my question. Thank you very much.
Okay, I just want to clarify your question. Are you asking how will America face the globalization challenges?
I'm not sure the question either. Maybe if you could clarify.
Asking, you know, yeah. You all differ.
Yes. Yeah, thanks. Thank you.
Before, you have American election.
Yes.
And after that, one of the party will win.
Yeah.
But the parties will work together. And, you know, before, they work together and develop everything in the United States.
Right.
And the United States is a leader. Until you say, I don't want to be a leader, you cannot, because you're leading in everything almost, okay? Mm. Now, but now you have problem. Somebody win the election, but there's problem after the election.
Mm-hmm.
The parties cannot work together. My question is, why this is happening? Is it related to global challenges, which is very difficult to solve, and we didn't find the answer yet to deal with these challenges? Is that the reason behind all this? We are not finding the right answer to the global challenges which we face together, and nobody can solve it alone. United States cannot solve it alone. It has to work with others to solve it. You know, and the other problem you have, when you have election, the election is very domestic. You know, you elect somebody for your region. Mm. But when this guy comes to the Congress, he's a global person because he has to deal with a lot of global challenges. This is my question.
Okay. That's a lot more clear. First of all, thank you for coming. I've been to Bahrain. It's a wonderful country. Thank you for hosting us. So the first step, I believe, for most working families in the United States and in the vision that Hillary Clinton has is to address the domestic problems at home first. Which is why the majority of her first 12 policies that she plans to restructure and propose during her first 100 days in office are completely about domestic issues. And then, hopefully, after we've had the opportunity to put our communities to work and improve them, you will then have an opportunity to address the global challenges that we have to participate in.
it's a resounding message that's being echoed throughout the United States. Hillary Clinton is paying attention to that, while at the same time addressing the global issues we face. With the environment the world is in now, with all the volatile events in the Middle East, and with the tension over here in Asia, it's difficult to balance the two. But I believe America will be better equipped and able to address those challenges once we address some of our own. And Hillary Clinton has that same vision. It's going to be a balancing act. It's tough. It's going to be remarkable to see what's going to happen in the next 4 years or 8 years, hopefully. Hopefully we approach this problem as a community, as a global community, and that we all unite to strive for the sort of global environment we want to live in. And for now, in America, Hillary Clinton just has to take care of the problems at home. And hopefully she'll be able to address those problems at the same time, too. So.
Well, I think the Greens don't place much trust in governments to begin with and want to restore power to people in their local lives. So one of their focuses in the 10 key values that I passed out earlier is one of them is personal and global responsibility, the idea that we need to take responsibility in our personal lives and then also be able to work with people from other countries with respect for diversity, rather than trying to think that America is going to lead everybody and everybody needs to follow the United States. We don't believe America first. We believe in respecting diversity and in joining together with people around the globe to work jointly on these kinds of problems. We also have one of the key values of decentralization, which means trying to push a problem down to its lowest level. If you look at a problem like global warming, okay, the Paris Accords just occurred recently, and do we really think that governments are going to follow through on their commitments to the Paris Accords to reduce CO2 gases to a level that would only permit two degrees rise in temperatures? It seems very doubtful. Can we trust the governments to do that? And the Greens would say, no, we can't really trust governments to do that. We need to take the power into our own hands to be able to work on these kinds of problems by working on them at the local level as much as we can.
The Libertarian Party's stance is that one of the reasons amongst the reasons for all this internal fighting is the fact that representatives are not accountable to the people, but they are accountable to the lobbyists, the donors, and to, that's money on both sides, and then to the parties themselves. So one of their ideas about dealing with this, because they don't think bigger government is better either, is to actually limit terms and have the reps, the representatives, be more accountable to the people they represent and to actual reform the lobbying system and the way money comes into government. And they believe this needs to be done at the domestic level to increase cooperation between the different parties first. And perhaps if we have better working internally, maybe then cooperation would be better outside. So some differences, some similarities.
OK, thank you for the question. It's a very thought-provoking one. I would say that although Donald Trump tends towards the protectionist in his policies, he's certainly not an isolationist. He knows that realistically we live in a globalized society now, and that living in that society involves a certain amount of cooperation with other countries. However, I think he would view that from the viewpoint of a negotiator. He deals with other countries. He doesn't want to give concessions to other countries just to give the veneer of cooperation all the time. Trump believes in American leadership. And even personally, as a foreigner, I would say that American leadership of the world is not a bad thing. America is currently the greatest superpower. It's the country every other country in the world looks up to, whether they want to admit it publicly or not. Its cultural exports are valued above any other countries. People go from all over the world to study at American universities. You couldn't say that about any other superpower or up-and-coming superpower. People perceive America as the wealthiest country, the most successful country. It's the country everyone aspires to be. Yeah, that's true. As far as American power overseas relates to this, it's been 70 years since we had a major world war. Now, people disagree on why that's the case. Some people would say it's the United Nations or the European Union, you know, open cooperation. Some people say it was the rivalry of the Cold War. Two superpowers kept things from flaring up. Other people say it's the Pax Americana. The US Navy patrolling major trade routes keeps them safe and open. So I think the Trump position on that would be that yes, we can have a safe and prosperous world, but that world can only exist when the US takes a leadership role. Thanks.
Time for one last question. There was somebody who had raised his hand, so I guess you're asking. I'd like to thank John for pointing out everybody wants to go to American universities. We just crossed the 1,000 student threshold, and I hope all of you, if you're not enrolled at TUJ, besides registering to vote, register to enroll at TUJ. So you raise hand. That's probably going to be the last question because we're going to run against the clock.
Okay. Thank you very much, and thank you to all of our panelists. It's been wonderful, and thank you to Temple University for hosting this event. I'd like to focus on a particular constituency that is Americans living overseas. There are about 8 million Americans estimated to live overseas from of all political stripes. And we have a lot of common issues that impact all of us, regardless of whether we're Democrats, Republicans, or any other party. Some examples are we have 13 states in which if American citizens have never resided in that state, they can't vote. They're not allowed to vote. We have issues of Medicare portability, issues of Social Security applying to American citizens overseas, and perhaps one of the most thorny issues, the Foreign Income Tax Compliance Act, which is intended as very strong anti-corruption legislation, but has had adverse impacts on American citizens, including not allowing or having forced them to close their bank accounts overseas. So, my question to the panelists is, what would your candidate do on any of those issues of your choice or others? What would they do to help the lives of the 8 million American citizens that are living overseas? Thank you.
45 seconds or less.
Well, we all know about the robust membership of Democrats abroad and its immense participation in the convention. And we know that there are congressmen, senators, various other diplomats, dignitaries that largely support. Sure. So it's very clear that the support is there for Democrats. We're not just Democrats abroad, but citizens abroad. There's concerns for voting rights and tax reform. And that support is met with immense support in the Democratic Party and with Hillary Clinton. So I think you'll continue to see progress for Democrats.
Very briefly, the Greens are not up to that level yet. We tried a few years ago, actually, even to get representation for the U.S. Greens abroad inside the Green Party of the United States in the United States, and we were denied representation within our own party.
Very honest.
And they're just not focused at all. They're not up to level.
Very quickly, I could make something up, but I did write to them several times, to the Libertarian Party and the Johnson campaign. I did write to them several times, and I have never had a response from them actually about this, because I was just curious. I would say that in reading the policy platform, the only advantage there would be for bringing family members
who do not have American citizenship back to the U.S. That's the only, in making that process streamlined, because they don't believe in breaking up families and deporting, breaking up families by deporting illegal immigrants. That's the only thing I can find right now.
Again, I don't think this this issue has been prominent enough in this campaign for us to speak with any authority on it. However, I'm pretty sure that looking at Americans living abroad, Trump would see that as an opportunity. He would see that as an opportunity to get more votes and supporters. So, absolutely, we'd like to build that. And I think we can. We all know that Donald Trump is in favor of everyone paying less taxes.
Well, thank you so much. I'd like to thank all the participants. I'd like to thank Motoko. Are you here? No, she stepped out. So I'd like to thank her. But and I'd like to thank the audience. And Motoko, I'd like to thank you for bringing this to the attention of the media here. I'd like to thank all the media for coming. And I'd like to thank all of our brilliant staff from the school, from ICAST, to make this possible. They don't speak, you don't see their names on the program, but really without all our students here, there'd be no video, there'd be no sound, there'd be no room, there'd be no chair, there'd basically be nothing, and there wouldn't be any speakers either. So thanks again to all of you, and thank you, Sarajean, for leading the effort to get such a great panel.
Thank you very much, everyone, for coming.